This is the story of George Michael.
Hi.
A story of hedonism, power, sex, and a money-making machine on which he pulled the plug. In our rummage through his wallet, we reveal his spending habits.
He was just totally direct. Cost more money? Fine. My money, I'll do it.
And we uncover what George's former video director really thought of him.
It's lack of conscience, ignorance, lack of grace, egotism, weakness, duplicity, and hypocrisy.
We speak to the man who created the million-dollar image for Faith.
Somebody at the PR company called me and said, oh, we're using the sniffing the armpit shot.
And we exclusively reveal how he cashed in on that sweet smell of success.
George, you're in the commercial. You've sold out. It's not like we're asking you to hold, you know, a bag of tampons.
And we visit the scene of the most famous toilet stop in history where his career hit the skids.
You're right now walking through the Will Rogers Memorial Park.
We exclusively get the judge's reaction.
Unfortunately, he did what I think is a very immature and foolish thing.
And what does he spend his money on? We open the doors to one of his swankiest pads.
He may be famous for improving his assets by shoving a shuttlecock down his trousers, but we can now prove the bulge in his wallet is anything but tiny, as we reveal George Michael's millions.
George Michael started life as Yoyos Panyutu, shortening this to Yoyos Panos on rare copies of his first single. Panamas. Throughout his career, he's continued to reinvent himself, from Princess Diana clone to leather-clad ferry biker, through to moody maturity. In Wham, he was one half of the biggest commercial band of the 80s. He went on to become a solo phenomenon with six number ones from his debut album, and now he's older, he's been taking a pop at the politicians. He sold more than 67 million records worldwide, amassing 11 UK number ones and a fortune in the process.
At Club Tropicana, drinks might be free, but after two decades as an extremely successful artist, rivaling Madonna and Michael Jackson, George can certainly afford his own. Can I have a cherry in this next time, George?
But this world of glamour and excess was in sharp contrast to his humble beginnings.
This is Finchley in North London, a fairly average street. Certainly no indication, no blue plaque, that one of Britain's most controversial pop stars was born here on the 25th of June 1963, above what used to be a laundrette.
As Kenny grew up into George, Dad was toiling away in the family restaurant.
And all the hard work paid off, because when George was 12, he and his family moved here to leafy Millionaires Row in Bushey in Hertfordshire.
His parents dreamt of nothing more than George getting a good education, but young George dreamt of nothing less than superstardom. Dear mommy, dear daddy, you
have plans for me. Oh yeah, I was your only son. It was a short ride in his daddy's Rolls-Royce to Bushey Mead School, where his life would change forever.
Right to the classroom, Dad, and I get beaten up by that Andrew Ridgely bloke.
While Andrew doodled at the back of class, George sat up front with school chum Mark Berkeley, who remembers George's first day.
He was older than everyone else, and he looked a bit older. He was fairly quiet, though. I think he just wanted to get on and do his work.
So, could you be cruel and describe him as a swot, then?
Yeah, I guess he was a swot, yeah.
The apple he brought for teacher would, of course, go to his former music coach, Joy Mendelssohn.
So what are these, then, you've got in front of us?
These are some of the old programmes.
78 end-of-term concert.
Yes, and as you can see, Yorius played a drum solo. He was shy, he didn't like appearing so much in public. He just became a different person once he was on stage.
Was Andrew in this?
No, he wasn't musical, believe it or not, at school.
Oh, I can believe it.
The Ridgely boys were both very different to Yogurt, as we called him. They ruined one of my first lessons at school because I was so northern, even more so then, and I said the word path, And so they were, ha-ha, she can't speak properly. And they were just, oh, they made my lesson horrible.
Bad Boys indeed, but it would be years until George could be teased about his dress sense and bleached blonde hair. For the time being, it was spots, curls and puppy fat.
He had a big mass of frizzy hair.
Tan was there.
Glasses.
He was quite spotty, quite chubby.
So he didn't look anything like George Michael became.
Under the influence of that naughty Andrew Ridgeley, George started to bunk off school to pursue his dreams of stardom and riches. It's here at Green Park Tube Station that George Michael earned his first pennies as a busker. Thanks, Governor, 5p. It's a far cry from the multi-million pound deals that he does now, but it was also here at Green Park that Andrew Ridgeley persuaded George to get a few mates together and form their first band, The Executive. All that remains of The Executive is this rare poster. At their first gig, it wasn't the music that surprised people, but George's new look.
Everybody take a look at me, I've got street credibility. He did change pretty much overnight once they started their group up. Well, he's lost his glasses, he'd lost weight, his hair was different, he just looked completely different.
Did he move to the back of the class?
No.
So he's still got good marks?
He's still got good marks, that's right.
But the band didn't. Universally deemed awful, The Executive split. George and Andrew decided to go it alone. But to fund their dreams, they needed cash. They needed a job. Get yourself a job, get out of this house. Get yourself a job, you a man or a mouse. We uncovered rare footage of George's alternative career.
I worked here for 9 months. This is the Empire Cinema in Watford. And I can't even pretend I got this far. I was never promoted to front desk. I was one of the ones who tore the tickets as you went in.
When he wasn't collecting cinema stubs, George spent a lot of time here at Monroe's studio in London. Record producer Roger Benu remembers the aspiring Cockney.
So this used to be Halligan's Band Centre, where George and Andrew came to rehearse Careless Whisper. Now, you were part of a group that auditioned George in well before the Wham days.
That's right, yeah. We had a band that was instrumental-based and auditioned, I don't know, 30, 40 different people until eventually George was one of those, and I was totally knocked out. I thought, this guy's superb. Few of the members weren't too happy about the fact that it might take the band into too much of a commercial or pop-orientated audience. And
he was too good then?
Too good for the band, I think, yeah.
Just as it looked like George's dreams of pop stardom were over, Mark Dean, who ran record label Innervision, barged into the studio. He'd heard Wham rap and wanted to make George and Andrew stars.
As far as Mark Dean and Innervision Records were concerned, it was no expense spared. George and Andrew were rushed by a fleet of limos from those recording studios there to sign their first contract in this greasy spoon here.
It was a contract they would later regret signing, but it wasn't unusual in the pop world.
When they were signed to this contract, was this a particularly bad example, or was this, you know, going around every band like Frankie?
Well, Frankie Goes to Hollywood would have signed an almost identical deal, a few hundred quid up front. The great opportunity, obviously, was to go in a recording studio. That was the lure, really. As soon as he signed it, he could make a record. George obviously was convinced in his own ability that his song was going to get on top of the pops. This piece of paper would have enabled that.
So from this contract, they would have got 500 quid and then royalty rates of 8%, which is fairly tiny.
It's ridiculous, but what the problem is, and it was the same problem with Frankie Goes to Hollywood signed to their label, is that Innervision have a deal with CBS. So Innervision are like the act, if you like. So they'll be getting fairly average, measly 12 points from CBS. And Wham were part of Innervision, so therefore Innervision can't obviously give Wham 12 points because that's all they're getting from CBS, so they give them 8, they take their 4. So it's a miserable deal, about half of what you would really be expecting a good deal to be.
More Careless Signature than Careless Whisper. Their first record contract would only earn them £500 each, but it did get them on Top of the Pops.
Tonight it's the first chart of November. It's my first Top of the Pops, and it's their first Top of the Pops. Wham!
And they made the most of it. Their performance of Young Guns whipped Mike Smith and the audience into a pop frenzy. The press compared George and Andrew to Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. I'll let you decide who was Butch. Wham were on a roll, but thanks to that record contract, not on the bankroll. All you could say was hot dodge meet my fiancé. Young Guns climbed quickly to number 3.
and their follow-up single Wham Rat reached number 8, and next release Bad Boys peaked at number 2.
But what Wham really wanted was a number 14. Bus, that is. After 3 top 10 hits, they were still skint, and catching the bus to and from the Top of the Pop studio. Next stop, it was time to get some managers.
In order to make money, they hatched a plan at this restaurant with management team Simon Napier-Bell and Jazz Summers.
The first thing was to make them as big as we could. They had to be enormously successful. There was no point going into a legal battle with a record company when you're only a moderate-sized group. The record company would probably just drop you and hold you up from getting on with your career and you'll fade away. So we embarked on Wham! Tour, which the sole purpose was to create a sort of Wham! Mania copy of what Beatlemania had been in the 60s. And of course it also gave Wham! Some money and some guarantee they'd earn money in the future, so they had money to pay the legal bills.
This rare footage of George and Andrew preparing for the concert shows them choosing their new look. Unfortunately, a sponsorship deal with Fila, set to net Wham! £50,000, fell through as the fans, many too young to buy the gear, ended up stealing it from the shops instead. But George and Andrew liked the sporty look, and the concerts made a huge impact.
Well, for me, the most significant moment in the show was when George and Andrew sort of came on with these badminton rackets and had these shuttlecocks. And I think Andrew sort of teased the audience when he sort of ran the shuttlecock up his arm, and George surpassed that when he put the shuttlecock down his trousers, or his shorts, I should say.
In the British Library archive, we discovered another tactic in Wham's march to world domination.
They very shrewdly targeted the lucrative teen market. In this rare edition of My Guy magazine, George even went as far as appearing in a photo love story.
In Too Much, Too Young, George sulked about his friend getting married. In real life, George sulked about his record contract and refused to hand over any new material to Innovision. In a counterattack, Mark Dean released a remixed EP. George wasn't happy.
We're just about to play Love Machine for you. Right, there are two tracks that are on a 12-inch that's coming out next week, and we really don't think you should buy it. I'm just a love machine.
Wham's first tour, less the cost of the shuttlecocks, would earn them £10,000 each. It also boosted sales, sending their album 3 times platinum. But under that contract, it would only pocket George £140,000.
George, have you made a lot of money?
No, not really. And what money we've made, we probably won't get to see, because it gets spent before you get to see it. There are certain reasons why we haven't made anything like as much money as most people would probably believe, but, you know, we're certainly not short of a few bob.
Their early hits may not have made them millionaires, but CBS realised Wham's potential and encouraged Mark Dean to release them from their contract. Though was still a bit touchy.
It makes me angry when people abuse their position. In any, you know, officious people make me really angry.
I make George angry.
Andrew makes me angry, yeah. And how do I show it? Well, I make the occasional solo record.
Doing without Andrew's guitar strumming, George released Careless Whisper as a solo single. With the help of keyboardist Andy Richards and sax player Steve Gregory, it was to be a huge money spinner.
I just walked in and I heard this lovely song with George singing it and thought, my goodness, I'm about to play on a massive hit single. It was just so evident.
Thought, oh, it's a ballad, it must just be an album track. You know, a couple of weeks later, it was everywhere.
Careless Whisper reached number one on both sides of the Atlantic, due in part to the world's most famous sax solo.
So, come on, give us a bit of the sax then, because, you know, it's a very famous part of the song. It almost overshadowed George's writing.
Don't say that.
Yeah, I think I could have done that. George wants to give me a call next time. Which button do I press?
It's during the filming of this video that we uncover the first example of George's reckless spending and a hairdo gone crazy. Carina Camomile, the producer, agreed to talk exclusively about that shoot.
It was actually one of the biggest videos that he'd undertaken at that time. And we had all kinds of locations and models, and it was set around two women in his life and the conflict between that. And one of the things that occurred during that time is that the humidity, he has the same type of hair I do, humidity goes. You notice in the yacht scenes he has a cap on. I mean, part of that was to look like, okay, I'm out here, I'm sporty, I'm having fun, you know, I'm hanging off the side of the boat. But it was also to keep his hair under control. But after a couple of days, he pulled me aside and said, we can't go on like this, so we need to reshoot and make sure I can do something else with my hair to make it be right.
So how much was the budget for this whole Careless Whisper video then?
The budget at the time was £30,000, and it probably was in the region of £17,000 for us to reshoot the 2 days that we'd lost.
So 50% more for a haircut?
It's a lot of money. It is.
It's the most expensive haircut in 80s pop.
Mm-hmm.
The money would come from George's royalties, and halting the shoot was a mere cut and blow dry at £17,000. But who was this cheated friend? Who was the wasted chance that he'd been given? We found the answer in Santa Barbara. It was school sweetheart Helen Tolkien.
So this photo is of you and your classmates and George at Stratford-on-Avon, because everybody had to go there sometime. So you dated, and then about, what, 15 years later you found out the Careless Whisper was written about you and George's relationship. Is that a bit of a surprise?
Yeah, it was a big surprise. I remember him playing the song to me when he had written it, and he had a demo tape. So that was a long time before it was actually released. But I didn't get it. I didn't realise that it was in any way about us.
And were you a bit hurt when you realised the song was about him going out with somebody else who'd two-timing you?
No, I thought it was funny. I just thought, oh, God, that explains it.
Did you ever notice any, say, guilt in George's dancing?
No.
So, after all these years, we can finally put a face to the woman responsible for George's crap dancing and one of his most enduring songs. Careless Whisper sold over 1 million copies in the UK alone, earning George an estimated £300,000. If you take into account worldwide sales, that figure is more like £1.5 million. To increase their bank balances and world status, Wham had a cunning plan.
The British pop duo Wham have become the first Western group to appear in China. This afternoon, 12,000 Chinese fans packed the Workers' Stadium in Peking, though they had a problem saying the name. The nearest they get is Wei Mung, which means brave and audacious.
Their bravery would be how much they were willing to spend.
We had to pay for the entire thing. I mean, you had to pay for the concert tour and pay to print the tickets, pay for the person who sold them, and all the money was selling them went to charities. So there was nothing at all we didn't pay for. And the budget came to about £500,000.
To recoup some of the money, Wham made a film of the tour. This would prove to be a huge mistake. When the time came to film the performance, the crew were in for a surprise.
We encountered something we hadn't reckoned. Humidity. The humidity was shocking. His hair was curling, something rotten. So George said, look, I can't perform in this. Close-ups, my hair's turning into a frizz. Can't do it. Won't do it. Why can't we just do this in England? So in England, I said, George, it's very simple. You're right, we can shoot the whole thing at Shepperton. We can recreate this 400-year-old theatre. Get everybody there. It'll cost $500,000. George looked at me, blinked once and said, all right. I said, I beg your pardon? He said, it's all right. It's my money. I said, you're quite right, it's your money. Never argue with a rock star who wants to spend his money.
But argue they did. As George's perm and the cost of the film spiralled out of control, the director Lindsay Anderson made his feelings known in letters I uncovered in the archives of Stirling University.
These letters are actually quite bitter. They're all about George Michael having a huge ego and being a control freak. One of them says that George Michael seems to be the classic case of a shivering aspirant plucked out of the street who turns almost overnight into a tyrant of fabulous wealth.
Nice. And there's one at the bottom here saying, George Michael, of course, is quite used to shelving a £65,000 video if he doesn't like it. It'll be quite interesting to see if there's any limit to his reckless autocracy. Now, this is my favourite bit of the letter. This is literally the meat and two veg. I must admit, though, lack of conscience, ignorance, lack of grace, lack of scruple, egotism, weakness, duplicity and hypocrisy have characterised this whole operation. The only thing he doesn't mention is George's big hair.
And it wasn't just the film crew who were on the wrong end of George's temper. So too were the world's press, including John Blake.
They must have had 20 or 30 photographers and reporters all following them around everywhere they went. And they discovered things like the photographers would go mental if George and Andrew wore sunglasses. They'd wear sunglasses all the time. And at one point it got so fraught in the Great Wall of China that one of the photographers grabbed their sunglasses and threw them off the wall. So it was all very aggressive and strange and hostile. And even the gig itself was bizarre because they, you know, the Chinese people had no idea how they were supposed to react. So they didn't know what dancing was, really. But George and Andrew finally got them on their feet and showed them what to do, and they all got up and danced. And then the police ran along with great big sticks and hit people in the head and made them sit down again.
At least the big sticks stopped those terrible 80s moves. To make things worse, Wham's plan to make money by selling albums to China's teenagers hit a slight problem.
They said that if we sold millions and millions by any chance, would we like to be paid in bicycles? Because you can't get money out of China. So no, it wasn't a financial venture.
The tour would cost Wham a whopping £500,000. Add another £400,000 for the cost of that ill-fated film, and that's a loss of £900,000. Ouch! The China tour may have cost them a packet, but the publicity was priceless. They were now the biggest band in the world and their sales rocketed. Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go hit number one in over 8 countries, including America. That was followed by Everything She Wants and I'm Your Man. To cash in on their success, a 6-date tour of America caused hysteria among fans.
What do you think of Wham?
As if Tracy Barlow wasn't hysterical enough, George was about to send her hormones into a tailspin. He announced he wanted to break up Wham at the peak of their success. Having earned a mint from the American tour, their final gig at Wembley Stadium would be very different.
I think when the decision was made to have the final concert, it was never a financial decision. It was an emotional decision. Money really didn't come into it.
We'd love to have seen everyone off personally, but can't.
With no regrets about splitting up. So a huge thank you to everyone, not only today, but for the last 4 years.
The capacity of Wembley Stadium at that time was 72,000, and all the tickets sold out in a matter of about 2 hours. I mean, the queues were about a mile and a half, 2 miles long. We kind of briefly discussed the idea of doing another show, possibly on the Friday night, and calling it a semi-final. But I think that George and Andrew felt that really if there's going to be a final show, it should be one show. And one show is an event. And it was an event.
The Wham final cost £750,000 to stage and only managed to break even. But their tour across America was the real money spinner, the most lucrative of all Wham's tours, pocketing George a whopping £1.7 million. Wham were the biggest commercial band of the 1980s. George's share of sales was an estimated 11 million quid. Add in record deals, tour receipts, roughly 3 million, and that brings us to a total of £14.7 million. Not bad for a 23-year-old.
The party was over. George had pulled the plug on Wham at the height of their success. But like any good game show, they didn't leave empty-handed. They had millions in the bank, and each had a Robin Reliant, courtesy of Elton John, complete with furry dice in the window. Thank you, Elton. All George had to do was prove he could step it up a gear and make it as a solo artist. After the breakup of Wham, the expectations for George's solo album were huge. So was the pressure for a number one. This was his reply.
Faith was very much a solo affair, credited as writer, arranger, producer, and playing many of the instruments. The only thing George didn't control was the all-important image. That was down to photographer Russell Young. He spoke exclusively to me about how he created that look.
George arrived with, I think, the stylist and makeup were there. They put in a whole load of suits into the studio, hundreds, literally hundreds of suits. I set the lighting up, he repositioned it, told me where he wanted to put the lights, how he wanted, you know, how he looks best. It looked very sharp, I mean, it looked very clean, you know, almost like Robert Palmer. All day long, I'd sort of wanted to do something a little bit sexier. But I think he brought the Faith tape in to the studio as well, and listening to it, the sort of the image of the suit didn't really go with the music. I was shooting at a studio where my friend had an apartment, so I went downstairs into my friend's closet and got this leather jacket I knew he had. So I just asked him, take the shirt off, put the jacket on, this is going to look really good, you know. And we shot one roll in colour and one roll in black and white. And the colour was the Faith album sleeve and the black and white was the Faith single sleeve.
The image was later dubbed the Fairy Biker look, complete with leather jacket, shades and designer stubble. The sale of beard trimmers rocketed.
And how much do you think that image was worth to him, in just in terms of sales? Because you just chanced upon it, but it was extremely successful.
Millions. Millions and millions, I guess, you know. Whether he likes it or not, you know, I mean, yeah, I guess it launched that whole new phase of his career. I got a free leather jacket 8 years ago because of that. For some reason, the conversation came up that I had taken that picture and this guy said, oh, you made, you know, billions of dollars for the leather industry and we've never had a better time than after that, you know, for the 4 or 5 years after that.
Do you feel guilty when you walk past a field of cows?
Well, yeah, I killed billions of cows.
Russell Young and Foot and Mouth, the biggest cow killers of all time. But the image worked. Faith was a multi-million dollar success and George was back. James Gillespie compiles the official chart and bows to the all-conquering Faith.
Faith was absolutely huge. At the time, it was in the American charts for over a year. It was number one, two Christmases on the trot. It was outselling current albums by Michael Jackson, by Bruce Springsteen. The Faith video and all the videos from that album were very, very suited to MTV, and so they got maximum exposure. And yeah, you have to remember, it's a time when MTV was quite new and it was having a lot of impact on record sales at that time. It sold around about 15 million copies worldwide, which is, you know, which puts it right up there with the most successful acts.
The Faith album, including hits I Want Your Sex, Father Figure and Kissing a Fool, has now gone 4 times platinum and remains his highest selling album. George's cut was a staggering £21 million. On top of that, the huge 160-date Faith tour earned George a further £4.1 million. Sony then bought out CBS and offered George a 7-album deal, including a massive cash advance of £7 million. But it was another deal that later triggered an incredible sulk. But for now, George was impressed with the size of his bank balance, a staggering £47 million. His fairy biker look was now a commodity. And the money-drenched advertising world wanted to buy it. Diet Coke made the sweetest bid, and we secured an exclusive interview with the man behind the ad, Paul Capelli.
George said he wanted to do the commercial because he drank it every day. He drank 6 of them a day. If I remember correctly, he's actually the one that came up with the idea of this matador.
So when he started shooting, what were the kind of list of demands that George was laying down?
He would not drink the product. He would not hold a can of the product. He would have it in the same room, but not too close to him. He then told us that he would not sing on stage. He then told us that we could not use his music in the commercial. So out of all of it, we got maybe 5 seconds of George's face, and that's it.
The commercial was so bad it only aired 3 times, and this is the first time it's been seen in the UK. Somebody give me a break now.
He even came to the edit sessions with us to make sure that he wasn't in too much of the video. And in the final scene where we freeze on his face, he made us stretch the video, stretch it north and south, so that he would look thinner. I would say it was pretty much a complete disaster. Somebody give me a break, man. I firmly believe that he laughed all the way to the bank and he just said, too bad.
For simply standing in the same room as a can of Coke, George Michael earned $3 million. That's another £1.85 million in the can. And as if by magic, his next purchase would cost exactly that amount, a house in the Santa Barbara Hills.
Now, he may not live here anymore, but we've been given exclusive access to look round one of George's swankiest pads, Open Sesame. So I'm guessing it's the view that sells this place, isn't it?
Certainly. It's one of the most magnificent views in the area, in Santa Barbara. We're standing out on kind of a prow of the design, like the prow of a ship, facing the best views. Starting in that direction, we can see all the way down to Ventura, that's towards Los Angeles. We can probably see 30 miles of coastline.
And as well as the view then, you've got the ultimate rock star accessories down there. First of all, starting with a tennis court.
I can see why he would like this house, yeah.
And over to the right, the pool, and complete privacy.
Yes, except for maybe an occasional hang glider that comes across.
Which you can shoot out of the sky anyway.
I suppose.
And how much did he pay for this place then?
I think it was about $3 million.
$2.3 million he sold it for, so he lost $700,000.
Yes, but plus the amount that he put into it.
Right. The irony now is it's worth, what, $10 million?
That's what I understand, right.
Right. Should we go inside and have a look? See what it is. Wow. Perfect rock star pad, this, isn't it?
I would think that this would have some good parties up here, yes.
Short of throwing a TV out of the window, which you could because there's so many.
Yes.
There's nothing left to do.
George Michael is not a collector of art, but the Tate Gallery is the closest we can get to taking a look at his latest house.
This is Goring Millen Church, painted by Turner just under 200 years ago in 1807. Now, this here is George Michael's house, and this is worth £10 million. That's the painting, not the house. The house is worth £1.5 million.
Playing the property game has proved a right little earner for George Michael. For example, this place in the Boltons in Chelsea was bought off Chris Evans for £7.25 million. George didn't even move in, but he sold it on to Puff Daddy for a cool £1 million profit. Oi, Puffy, your nets are filthy. He still owns Shea Nobby, that's another charming nickname of his, which he bought in Saint-Tropez for £1.8 million.
Another recent acquisition for George has been a £10 million mansion here in Highgate in North London. If he gets a bit lonely, he'll need a cup of sugar. He can pop round to neighbours Annie Lennox and Sting.
And this house on the outskirts of Beverly Hills was snapped up for £1.7 million. And finally here in West Hampstead. When I say here, I actually mean over there. That's called Weeping Ash. That's the first house he bought in 1987. He paid £2 million for it in cash. It's all a long way from a pokey flat above a laundrette and takes his bricks and mortar assets to an estimated £18 million, which brings our running total to just over £67 million. George Michael had this special bit of decking built because he liked the view, and you can see why. It helped him pen the lyrics to Listen Without Prejudice. It was also here he took the momentous decision to kill off the lucrative Faith image. George took himself completely out of the picture. Not only did he refuse to appear on the cover of the album, but he would no longer appear in any of his videos. Instead, his single Freedom featured the world's top five supermodels: Naomi Campbell, Cindy Crawford, Linda Evangelista, Tatiana Patiz, and Christy Turlington. Their wages alone would top £300,000. In the video, he also burnt his trademark leather jacket in an attempt to distance himself from his sex symbol image. Sony watched the sales figures of Listen Without Prejudice very closely.
Well, the sales in the UK were comparable to Faith. It did about four times platinum, which is 1.2 million sales. In America, it was right down. It did about 20% of what Faith did. It was still a global hit. But no, it didn't emulate the success of Faith.
George blamed Sony for not promoting the album, and Sony in turn blamed him for exactly the same thing. George felt he was seen as nothing more than a commodity. Things were about to turn ugly.
October 92, here at the Sony HQ in New York, George and the company's executives faced off. George said he was being treated little better than software and wanted out.
George's lawyer issued a writ describing his contract as professional slavery, and they ended up at the High Court in London. Implying the contract was loaded against him, George told the court on sales grossing 99.5 million quid, Sony pocketed over 52 million, whilst he received just over 7 million. After one of the longest court cases in music history, the judge finally threw out George's claims, ruling the contract was legally binding, and Sony were within their rights to get George to finish his seven-album deal.
I have no right to resign. In fact, there is no such thing as resignation for an artist in the music industry. Effectively, you sign a piece of paper at the beginning of your career, and you are expected to live with that decision, good or bad, for the rest of your professional life.
He was never going to win it. What he did win was his freedom, effectively, because he just said, OK, whilst I'm signed to Sony, I will never record again. Sony does not want to sit on any of its assets and think we're not going to make any money out of this. So it was clear that from the moment that the court case started, that actually Sony were already negotiating with anyone else who would be willing to take this act off their hands and pay them some sort of small royalty on his future earnings.
To the rescue rode Virgin and the entertainment group DreamWorks. They paid Sony a one-off sum of $40 million to buy George out of his contract. In return, George signed a two-album deal with an advance against royalties of $10 million.
Now, the clever thing for George is that once again he's able to challenge his worth in the open market, and so George, as a result of this, is suddenly worth another $10 million. Thanks very much. Put that in the bank.
George took his revenge in the video to Fast Love, the word phony on the headphones, a swipe at his former record company. And George definitely had the last laugh. In the new deal, DreamWorks agreed to a record-breaking royalty rate of 20%. And with his next album, Older, selling 2.5 million copies worldwide in its first week, that bagged George another $4 million. His courtroom capers cost him in the region of $3 million, but royalties from his albums Older and Songs from the Last Century have bagged him an estimated £14 million, easily covering the costs, which brings his big bad wad to just over £81 million. Throughout the Sony dispute, George's bank balance flatlined, but he continued to record charity singles. All the proceeds from Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me with Elton went to AIDS benefits, but George has always been generous with his cash when it comes to charity. Back in 1985, he lent his vocals to Band Aid and donated the profits from last Christmas, some £250,000, to the Famine Appeal. It's here in San Francisco at the Open Hand Charity, which prepares meals for people with HIV and AIDS, that we witness George's generosity. Tom Nolan made me wear a very fetching hat to tour the kitchen.
One day they open the mail and there's a check for $25,000 from George Michael.
What, no letter?
No letter, no note, nothing.
And what does that mean to you? How does that turn out in terms of meals?
You know, immediately we translate everything into the number of meals, and $25,000 represents over 8,000 meals. So that's a lot.
And in 1992, it was fairly risky for any artist to get involved in charities that supported AIDS.
Really, it was still, he was like the first big celebrity that actually helped. And after then, we've been fortunate with a number of people who helped us, Elizabeth Taylor, Neil Young, and Robin Williams, who lives here. But George was really the first and kind of opened the door, I think, for others to say, yeah, this is a good thing to do.
In 1992, George was named Britain's most generous star, donating £500,000 to charity in 1 year, putting him in the country's top 20 benefactors.
Obviously, there are two reasons why a celebrity would give money to charity. Not only is it a genuine altruistic wish to better the lives of other people, but there is also a tax benefit. And in effect, what they're getting is a tax relief of £3,000 for every £10,000 that they give. So if, as we imagine, George Michael has given up to £5 million, and that's probably a conservative figure, you can see that he will have got that back on tax relief.
So as well as a big heart, it helped his big wallet. We estimate that George Michael's charitable donations have topped £5 million. Charity begins at home, and some would say that's why George Michael created his own record label, Aegean, and put his cousin Andreas in charge.
Okay, here's the deal. Brand new singer, brand new song, brand new record label, which just happens to be mine, and a brand new video. This is Toby Bourke and my good self singing Waltz Away Dreaming.
She's got a song in her head, and she'll sing to me.
Plucked from the Irish pub circuit, Toby couldn't believe his luck, but that was before he saw George's cousin in action. He talked exclusively to Liquid Assets, down the local fake Irish boozer, about the problems at Aegean and his Dune single.
Waltz away dreaming till your day begins.
The week of release, Andros and George, or Andros certainly, had failed to convince the strike force, the sales force, that this song was going to be a bigger hit as it was. With the consequence that we actually ran out of records in shops on the Thursday night. This ridiculous situation of George Michael sitting in Andros's office, ringing branches of WH Smith's and Woolworths and asking if they have products in the store and saying, you know, sort of, hi, this is George Michael and the rest of it. And this guy probably going, get away. So when it came to Saturday, which is probably the biggest sales day you have in the life of a single, there wasn't the product in the shop. We dropped about five places from the midweek to the end. Ended up beating Gina G by one sale. Andros's office was enormous. I mean, it was one of the biggest offices I've ever seen in my life. And most importantly, it was about six times the size of the recording studio that was also based at Aegean. And I got a call from Bob Stemegner at the record company saying, hey, we're really happy. I think things are going to start happening now. And I thought, wait, don't tell me. We've got a distributor. And the answer was, no, we just have the office feng shui'd. And I was thinking, terrific.
They obviously didn't pay much attention to the money corner of the room. The Aegean label closed in 2001 with losses of roughly £400,000, leaving Toby waltzing on his own. Then things got very sticky indeed.
While we've been on air, police in Beverly Hills have confirmed that the singer, George Michael, has been charged with committing a lewd act in a park toilet.
The singer, George Michael, is still in hiding after his arrest in a Beverly Hills public toilet.
Police in Los Angeles have confirmed that they've arrested the singer, George Michael.
He was arrested in a public lavatory in a park in Los Angeles, but was later freed on bail.
You're right now walking through the Will Rogers Memorial Park, and I want to show you a point of interest over here that caused a lot of attention a few years ago. It's right over there. George Michael was suntanning on the lawn right over here when a guy was sitting across from him, started looking at him, and they started exchanging glances. So George Michael got up and walked to those bathrooms you see here on your right-hand side. And when the guy followed him, he found George Michael doing something he didn't really expect him to do. He pulled out a badge, and it turned out he was an officer of the Beverly Hills Police Department, and he arrested George Michael for public exposure.
What was George doing?
He was kind of playing with himself.
Yes, caught with his trousers down, at least George's indiscretion would prove another stop on the Hollywood celebrity tour. But his fate was in the hands of one man, Judge Charles Rubin.
The case came to me under his birth name, I suppose, not his celebrity name, so I wasn't aware that it was a celebrity case. And I just began to process it like any other case of that type.
Did George have expensive defense lawyers?
I don't know what his lawyer was paid, but the lawyer that he had was a former district attorney of Los Angeles County, so I'm assuming that he was in the upper range of fees.
Georgios Kyriakos Panayiotou.
I sentenced him to the usual sentence for a run-of-the-mill average defendant in this kind of a case, which is a $300 plus penalty assessment fine, a total of $810, and 80 hours of community service. The maximum fine is $1,000, with a penalty assessment of $2,700. For most celebrities, it's pocket change.
Worried about what effect his coming out would have on sales, George went on the offensive.
Why do you feel compelled to open up a very private part of your life and make it so public?
Well, I feel because I've kind of done that, haven't I? You know, I've done that in a way that I didn't really intend to. And I think having done something as stupid as that, I'm a very proud man. I want people to know. I don't feel any shame.
And to prove it, he exploited the arrest the only way he knew how. It may have been more village people than LAPD, but the single Outside did the business, reaching number two in the UK. And what did you think of the video? Did you think that was taking a swipe at you or the whole system or his offense?
All of the above, probably. And I thought it was childish.
Once again, George took revenge using his videos. But Officer Rodriguez, he's the guy on the throne with a badge, may have the last laugh. He's suing George for up to £6 million for emotional distress and slander. He went in to spend a penny, but came out with a couple of coppers, and that could still cost him big. The case is pending. Meanwhile, back on the Hollywood tour before Hugh Grant's lay-by, there's just one more treat.
What only a few people know is that George Michael actually violated another rule here in the park, which you see here on the sign where it says, no ball playing of any kind.
He'll just gag in the ball. Outside was never released as a single in America. Instead, it featured on his album Ladies and Gents. The publicity generated by the court case actually increased sales, sending the album 8 times platinum and pocketing George over $8 million. The whole toilet incident turned out to be just a flash in the pan and tipped his total value over £90 million. It wasn't long before George came back to the UK, where toilet humour is more appreciated. And it's here he made one of his most expensive purchases, a piano. It belonged to one of the country's greatest pop stars and is now housed in Madame Tussauds alongside the waxwork of its old owner. The piano once belonged to John Lennon, and it was the very one that he composed Imagine on.
Imagine all the people.
It's not the white grand piano which appeared in the video, but an upright Steinway complete with fag burns left by John as he composed the tune. When it came up for sale, it attracted bids not just from George Michael, but Robbie Williams and Noel Gallagher. Ted Owen organised the auction.
When it actually came up onto the block, the hair on my neck stood up. It was such an amazing... The room was absolutely solid packed.
And now we come to the last and most famous lot of the sale, the John Lennon Imagine Steinway.
The bidding started on the piano. I think it started at 500,000. And it went 6, 7, 8, 9.
1 million.
Yes!
1 million.
And I thought, great, my job's done. I've got my million, you know. And then I sort of looked round again. It was 1.1, 1.2, 1.3. George's manager was then in the room on a telephone, I believe, directly to George, and another guy personally bidding in the room.
1.4.
Andy Stevens, George Michael's manager, said 1.45. Going, going.
And it went.
For the last time, 1.450.
Years' time could well be worth $2-2.5 million.
It's a good investment, then.
Totally, yeah. There's no way that George is going to lose any money on that, and it is a good investment.
So in terms of pop memorabilia, this is Vincent van Gogh's Flowers, this is the Mona Lisa.
This is the Sunflowers, really, yeah. It's now in the Guinness Book of Records. It's the highest price ever achieved for A, a piano, and B, a piece of pop memorabilia.
Robbie and Noel dropped out of the bidding around the million mark, leaving George to snap up a bit of our musical heritage. The very shrewd move of putting it on public display has already raised its value to an estimated £1.5 million. Continuing his extravagant spending, George returned to the charts in one of the most expensive pop videos ever made. To Flick to Freak, described by the press as a kinkathon, was an orgy of special effects and sexual images. I got an exclusive look at how the video was made.
The idea of this video is to be completely cinematic, and this is a Blade Runner tribute look of that style and the large scale of everything. You get yourself an action, said you get yourself a body. You get yourself an answer, mind out of tune, bring something to the party. Movies are $100 million, and so this has the style of a movie. We ended up doing this in terms of the visual effects for around $500,000.
Since he would no longer promote his singles in the flesh, the publicity relied on his videos. To attract column inches, they were getting more risque and more expensive. The video to his single Fast Love was another high-tech outing, costing a quarter of a million, and the video to Outside, half a million.
So Freak, it's very much a video to kind of like top the previous videos. Is that how it was seen?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you always want to do something bigger and better the next time.
Half a million on special effects and 80,000 each on the rubber outfits. The final cost of Freak would be a huge £1 million. It broke the bank, but failed to break into the top five, only making number seven. Don't be scared of the dancing, that's what you gotta be prepared. George's next video would be less expensive, but no less controversial. In Shoot the Dog, he unwittingly picked a fight with the biggest music market in the world. The video depicted Bush as a fool and Blair as his lapdog, and post-September the 11th critics predicted that the song and video could end George's career.
You can't tell me that you did not intend to slam our country when you slam our president. By portraying him going to bed with your prime minister, you slam our country.
So why would an artist release a kamikaze video like Shoot the Dog, which could potentially alienate 40% of the world music market?
If he was bothered about his career and his image in America, he wouldn't be making political singles. He wouldn't be portraying George Bush to be to be an idiot. But I think it's probably more important to him these days to be singing about something that he cares passionately about than being successful in America. He's got enough money, it doesn't really matter what he does these days. So I think the fact that he's made a conscious decision to be happy, or to be as happy as he possibly can be with his output, I think is very admirable.
We took a quick poll from the people on the streets of New York. What did they think of George Michael?
I haven't heard much from him since the 80s.
I like his old stuff. I don't know much of the new stuff, so...
I think he got busted for whacking it somewhere, didn't he?
I think he's kind of fading away now. He's still a legend, though, I mean. But, I don't know, he's kind of the past now.
And his politics, God. I don't know. Times like this, I think we should all stick together.
Whenever any artist steps up beyond their pocketbooks and makes a political statement, it's wonderful.
The only thing America agrees on is that George has made no impact on the charts for a very long time. So how has that affected his finances?
George funnels all his money through a company called Nobby's Hobbies Holding. And in 1988, which was at the start of his solo career, had all that Wham! Revenue coming in, plus the revenues from Faith, his first solo album. And that was when he made £16 million. He was at the peak of his popularity. And more recently, it's dwindled to about £2.5 million. Since his outing, after the incident in the park in America, he's very much shied away from the American market, which is a huge market for any artist. And what's more, his records just haven't been as good and as popular.
His honeymoon with America is over, but George Michael has come a long way in 20 years, from life above a laundrette to a life of luxury. He's got millions rolling in, but without the tabloid battles and the courtroom fights, he could have had millions more. So how much is George Michael worth?
Taking into account his homes, recording contracts, royalties, ticket sales from his tours and wages from his companies, we come up with an exclusive liquid assets wad of £95 million.
It's very simple. George Michael has great talent. He's one of the great songwriters of our time. He knows what he wants in life, and he stood the test of time.
With £95 million in the bank, what on earth do you buy him for his birthday? What could the man who has everything possibly want?
I think George wants to just play a bit more. He sort of has done his work. He did his work while the rest of us were, you know, at university or whatever.
Tell him yourself, tell him yourself.
That's when he was making his money, Asian, and now he can sit back and just enjoy it.
And lately he's been playing at politics. He's now as much at home on the Breakfast with Frost sofa as on the Top of the Pop stool. Could the next step be George Michael, MP?